I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace to you. It's such a joy to welcome you to the online ministry of Unionville Church. If this is your first time worshiping with us, it's an honor to have you here today. If this is not your first time, we're glad you decided to come back and worship with us again. I am Pastor Doug Myers, and I have the privilege of serving in this community and leading our time of worship this day. The Unionville United Methodist Church is a family-oriented church located in Nooswickley Township. We're in that southwestern corner of the Pennsylvania map known as Beaver County. You can find us by looking for the only red spot. But it sounds like we'll be moving into the yellow phase shortly. But we're still quite a ways from gathering here in the sanctuary. So I'm glad we have found this new means of sharing a time of worship together. And I'm glad you chose to join us in this time to offer praise and worship and gratitude to our Lord. So let's worship. Friends, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I invite you to join me in today's call to worship. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit and set our hearts ablaze, and you will renew the face of the earth. As we invite the Lord to be with us, we do so in a spirit of prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in whom we live and have our being, you created us for yourself, so that our hearts are restless until they find rest in you. Grant to us such piety of heart and strength of purpose that no selfish passion may hinder us from knowing your will and no weakness from doing it. Creator God, whose fingers sculpt sun and moon and curl the baby's ear, Holy Spirit, who watches over chaos before the naming of the day, Savior, who sends us to the earth's ends with water and words, allow us to know of your presence with us in this time of a global health scare. Turn our hearts from fear of a virus to confidence in you. Surprise us with your desired end to this pandemic. We give you thanks for the healthcare workers whom you have called to serve as agents of your healing grace, angels distributing your love. Join us this morning as we give you thanks and praise and glory. For though we are in different places, we gather in the name of the one who calls us, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. It is always a blessing to hear people with musical gifts. Today we're honored to have Karen Keppen bring us an anthem, Praise You in the Storm. Karen?
I was sure by now, God, you would have reached out. Wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise to God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hands, you never left my side. And though my heart is torn, I will praise you in the storm. I remember when I stumbled in the wind, you heard my cry to you and raised me up again. My strength is almost gone. How can I carry on if I can't find you? And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain. I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise to God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand, never left my side. Though my heart is torn, I will praise you in the storm. I lift my eyes into the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I lift my eyes into the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. You are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hands, never left my side. And though my heart is torn, I will praise you in the
storm. During a trial in a small Missouri town, the local prosecuting attorney called his first witness to the stand. The witness was a proper, well-dressed elderly lady, the grandmother type, well-spoken and poised. She was sworn in, asked if she would tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth on the Bible, so help her God. The prosecuting attorney approached the woman and asked, "Mrs. Jones, do you know me?" She responded, "Why, yes, I do know you, Mr. Williams. I've known you since you were a young boy, and frankly, you've been a big disappointment to me. You lie, cheat on your wife, manipulate people, and talk badly about them behind their backs. You think you're a rising big shot when you haven't the sense to realize you never will amount to anything more than a two-bit shyster. Yes, I know you quite well." The lawyer was stunned. Not knowing what else to do, he pointed across the room and asked, "Mrs. Jones, do you know the defense attorney?" She again replied, "Why, yes, I do. I've known Mr. Bradley since he was a youngster, too. He's lazy, bigoted, has a bad drinking problem. The man can't build or keep a normal relationship with anyone, and his law practice is one of the worst in the entire state. Not to mention, he cheated on his wife with three different women. Yes, I know him." The defense attorney almost fainted. Laughter mixed with gasps thundered through the courtroom, and the audience was on the verge of chaos. At this point, the judge brought the courtroom to silence, called both counselors to the bench, and in a very quiet voice said, "If either of you ask her if she knows me, you're going to jail." The words of a witness have great power. The words of a witness can be instrumental in sending a person to prison for life, or sending a person to heaven for eternity. I was a pre-law student in my undergrad days, and while I'm not much of a television person, I do enjoy courtroom dramas. In such shows, the outcome often hinges on the intersection or the interaction between one of the attorneys and one of the witnesses. In some cases, when technical or medical or psychological insight is important, the witness may be an expert, someone trained in a specific field and often paid for their testimony. But in the majority of cases, the witness is simply like any of us, an impartial observer, some would say an innocent bystander, who simply shares with the judge and jury what they believe to be the truth. And too often we sell ourselves short. We undervalue the power of our personal testimony. The words of each of us has great power. We see that in today's New Testament reading. Our passage is a courtroom drama of sorts with the Apostle Paul, the central character. Since in this season, the timing of the lectionary is a bit off, let me set the context. Today's reading takes place when the disciples are on their missionary journeys. Paul and Barnabas had a disagreement and decided to split up. See, there have been disagreements in churches since the church was born. Barnabas and John Mark set sail for Cyprus, and Paul and Silas headed through Asia Minor, through what is today Turkey. In the town of Derbe, Paul and Silas met a young man named Timothy, who would become Paul's protege. Paul and Silas continued on to Macedonia, modern-day Greece, with Timothy joining in their mission. Traveling on land and sea, they visited Philippi, where they were thrown in jail, then went on to Thessalonica and to Berea. In each city they visited, Paul would lead them to the synagogue, where they would preach the gospel to all who would listen. Paul was a polarizing figure. His message challenged the Jews to make a choice, whether or not to accept this message about Jesus as the risen Lord. In Berea, some people were becoming agitated with Paul, so to keep Paul safe, the new believers whisked him off to the coast, where he sailed to Athens. Silas and Timothy stayed behind, but were told to join Paul as soon as possible. That sets the scene for this morning's New Testament reading. We're still in the book of Acts, the 17th chapter, though, and I'll begin with verse 16. And today, just for something different, I'm reading from the Bible in contemporary language, from the transliteration titled The Message. The longer Paul waited in Athens for Silas and Timothy, the angrier he got. All those idols. He discussed it with the Jews and other like-minded people at their meeting place. And every day he went out on the streets and talked with anyone who happened along. He got to know some of the Epicurean and Stoic intellectuals pretty well through these conversations. Some of them dismissed him with sarcasm. What an airhead. But others, listening to him go on about Jesus and the resurrection, were intrigued, saying, "That's a new slant on the gods. Tell us more." These people got together and asked him to make a public presentation over at the Areopagus, where things were a little quieter. They said, "This is a new one on us. We've never heard anything quite like it. Where did you come up with this anyway? Explain it so we can understand." Downtown Athens was quite a great place for gossip. There were always people hanging around, natives and tourists alike, waiting for the latest tidbit on most anything. So Paul took his stand in the open space at the Areopagus and laid it out for them. "It is plain to see that you Athenians take your religion seriously. When I arrived here the other day, I was fascinated with all the shrines I came across. And then I found one inscribed, 'To the God Nobody Knows.' I'm here to introduce you to this God so you can worship intelligently, know who you're dealing with. The God who made the world and everything in it, this master of sky and land, doesn't live in custom-made shrines or need the human race to run errands for him as if he couldn't take care of himself. He makes the creatures. The creatures don't make him. Starting from scratch, he made the entire human race and made the earth hospitable, with plenty of time and space for living, so we could seek after God and not just grope around in the dark, but actually find him. He doesn't play hide and seek with us. He's not remote, he's near. We live and move in him, can't get away from him. One of your poets said it well, 'We're the God created.' Well, if we're the God created, it doesn't make a lot of sense to think we could hire a sculptor to chisel a God out of stone for us, does it? God overlooks it as long as you don't know any better. But that time is past. The unknown is now known, and he's calling for a radical life change. He has set a day when the entire human race will be judged and everything set right. And he has already appointed the judge, confirming him before everyone by raising him from the dead." At the phrase, "raising him from the dead," the listeners were split. Some laughed at him and walked off making jokes. Others said, "Let's do this again. We want to hear more." But that was it for the day, and Paul left. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. When Paul presented the gospel, some laughed at him. Others said, "Tell me more." It's been that way since the coming of Christ. Why do you suppose that is so? Our text doesn't tell us all that Paul told them about, but knowing Paul, it's safe to say it wasn't brief. We're told he introduced God to them. He told them that God is near, that God is not man-made, that you can know God, that you can be in relationship with God. This is when our text tells us the listeners split. This is when Paul lost many of his listeners. Those of us who at some point in our life made the decision to follow Jesus often find it difficult to understand why anyone would reject the gospel. There are some people in church circles who actually look down on people who are unwilling to commit their lives to Jesus. So let's try to view this event, this discussion between Paul and the people of Athens, through the eyes of those who sneered at Paul. Let's try for a moment to see what it was that led them to reject Paul, and in doing so, to reject the gospel. I think there are a number of reasons for this rejection. First of all, many likely didn't trust Paul. People can be suspicious, skeptical, especially when someone is questioning their beliefs. Some may have heard about Paul's past, how he was a persecutor of people following Jesus. And while some may have thought his conversion a testimony to life radically changed, others may have wondered, what's he going to try to sell us next week? How do we know he's sincere? And even if he's sincere, how do we know that he's right? So for some, the reluctance to believe may have been more about the messenger than the message, but not all. There were likely other reasons why people walked away. Some likely couldn't let go of tradition. Pointing to their idols, they may have replied to Paul saying, "Of course these are our gods. Our parents worship them. Our parents' parents worship them. Are you telling me that we've been wrong all along?" While I understand the reluctance to walk away from traditions, to turn from the beliefs of our parents and their parents, sometimes that is what God calls us to do. I have folks in my family tree that have said to me, "You keep saying that we have to go out and care for people beyond our church family. What's wrong with simply taking care of our own?" Who could argue with such honorable intentions? Caring for our church family, deepening our roots, growing our faith so that when people do come back to church, we're ready to receive them. It's with good intentions that we take that approach. But for starters, it's not very biblical. Matthew ends his gospel with the command of Jesus to his disciples to do what? To go and make disciples of all peoples, all nations, baptize them and teach them. Luke opens this very book of Acts with the ascension of Jesus, an event we'll look at in greater detail next week. But just prior to his leaving, Jesus said to his disciples, "You will be my witnesses, not to people who come to church, but in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." The disciples, that's you and me, folks, are to be witnesses in widening circles until the good news has covered the world. In addition to this biblical principle, there's a practical side to following Paul's lead in taking the gospel to strangers. And that is that fewer and fewer people are entering the doors of churches. But if ever there was a season in which we see that we can still be the church without sitting in sanctuary pews, it is today. We are living the reality of being the church beyond the walls. This isn't our choice, but it's an excellent opportunity to learn new ways of being church, new ways of teaching and learning, new ways of reaching further than we did when we were here in the comfort of our sanctuary worship. Comfort. That's what we cherish. Many of those listening to Paul would have been uncomfortable, realizing that the God of whom Paul spoke, the God to whom they are being introduced, is the antithesis of their icons, which leads to the underlying cause for their rejection of the gospel. Whereas their icons, their gods, made no demands on them, the God of whom Paul spoke calls them to a radical change of life. There it is, there is what is being rejected. It's difficult for people to change at all, but radically. It's hard for many of us to give up the comfort of the life we know. Yes, the life about which we constantly complain, and to step into a radically different life of which we have no control. And a life that is controlled by an intangible God. Many people prefer the feeling of being in control, of having a God they can control. We hear it in our prayers. Lord, heal me. Give my child a better life, my neighbor a new job. Take away my parents' cancer. We want to be in control. Even though we know that a God that can be controlled is really no God at all. Sharing a message of giving up control and comfort is a tough sell. A lot of discipleship is not easy, but it's the life for which we were made, and it's the life into which Jesus leads us. Before we're too harsh on these people who rejected Paul's message, let's remember that Luke tells us the listener's immediate reaction. Few of us make significant changes to our life by flicking a switch. Change is much more of a process. Paul is aware that some would embrace his message. To some, it would be simply seeds that he is planting in their heart. And Paul knew there would be others coming after him to nurture those seeds, to help them grow. And Paul knew that some people would just simply reject it. It happened back when Jesus first sent out his disciples. It was happening to Paul, and it happens to us today. Some folks, we simply hand over to God's Spirit and allow the Spirit to lead them to a place or a person where they would be more receptive. There's never been a shortage of reasons for people to sneer at or laugh at followers of Jesus. But let's not forget that some did become believers, and some said, "Tell me more." That's the joy in this morning's text, new people coming to Christ. Paul's mission was leading people to believe in Jesus. Paul undoubtedly was grateful for those who joined him, those who became followers and became believers. That had to fan the flames of Paul's passion to keep sharing. Even "tell me more" would have been music to Paul's ears. Like a salesman who visits a prospect and is told, "I'd love to hear more about your product. It sounds like just what I need." Paul would have been delighted to share more with them. There were some whose ears were likely tickled by what Paul had to say. They were not ready to make a commitment, but Paul had stirred enough interest in them that they at least wanted to hear more. Paul would have been okay with that as well. He would have kept moving on, though, knowing that others would come after him to reinforce his teaching and to once again introduce the gospel. Paul was well aware that knowing Jesus is not just about knowing facts, theories, ideas, or carefully worded theology. Developing a relationship with someone requires a commitment of time and energy. So it is with your relationship with Jesus as well. It takes time to learn some of the basic principles of the Christian life, and it takes spending time with Jesus to grow that relationship. Paul was aware that the Christian life is different. It's much more than a religion or a ceremony or a ritual or even law. Paul had lived that rigid life of religion before, and he had learned that his religion could not save him. He had to lose his religion and grow a relationship with Jesus in order to find eternal life. And that's what he wanted others to experience. Wouldn't you love to share the feeling Paul must have had when those first few came to believe? Wouldn't you like to be responsible for leading people to become followers of Jesus? I think we'd all love to play a part in growing God's kingdom. It's a wonderful desire. It's a wonderful life mission. Friends, know that not all of us are called to be Paul. None of us is Billy Graham. Don't take on the burden of saving the world. It will just paralyze you. We're called to simply share the gospel with others and the love of Jesus with whomever God places in our path. It's that simple, one person at a time. As I watch all the news reports of how this COVID-19 virus spreads, I can't help but see a parallel in how simply the good news of Jesus can be spread. There was a report out of Chicago of a man who was not aware that he had the virus. He shared a takeout meal with two family members and the following day attended a funeral in which he hugged other people. He also attended a birthday party with nine other people, a party in which hugs and food were included. Within 4 days, his family members became sick. Seven of the people at the birthday party became ill. And over the next several days, the man himself became sick, hospitalized, put on a ventilator, and died. But he wasn't done. Three of the people infected at the birthday party went to church, where there was singing and undoubtedly physical contact. Members in that church became ill. In all, this man, who did not feel ill, was responsible for infecting 16 people between the ages of 5 and 86. Three of those 16 also passed away. No, this isn't an upbeat way to end a sermon, but it's not the end. What if we knowingly spread the gospel of Jesus Christ? That was the plan Jesus put into effect. He grabbed two fishermen to be disciples and then two more. He then continued until he had a dozen. He then sent them out to touch the lives of others. We see it in the life of Paul. Earlier in Paul's journey, as he went through Philippi, he met a lady named Lydia. And when she responded to Paul's message, her entire family was baptized as believers. Sharing the good news and the love of Jesus does not take special skills. It takes first a willingness to receive the gospel, for we can't give away what we don't have ourselves. And it takes a willingness to go out and touch the lives of others. We've received the gift that is meant to be shared. We are blessed with that gift that we might be a blessing to others. Fritz Kreisler was a world-famous violinist who earned a fortune with his concerts and compositions, but generously, he gave most of it away. So when he discovered an exquisite violin on one of his trips, he found that he couldn't afford it. So he waited, and when he had saved enough, he returned to the cellar, but found to his dismay, the instrument had been sold to a collector. So Kreisler made his way to the new owner's home and offered to buy the violin. The collector said it was now his prized possession and it was not for sale. Disappointed, Kreisler was about to leave when he asked, "Could I just play the instrument once? Allow it to be heard one more time before it is consigned to silence?" The owner relented, and the great virtuoso filled the room with such heart-moving music that the collector's emotions were deeply stirred. The man exclaimed, "I have no right to keep that to myself. It's yours, Mr. Kreisler. Take it to the world and let the people hear it." Friends, we've been given the gift of the good news of Jesus, not to keep to ourselves, but to share that others may hear it. May we do so boldly, trusting the presence of the Spirit to touch the hearts of others and draw them into the heart of God, that God's kingdom may be expanded. May it be so. May we be used for God's glory. Amen. While most of us have remained safe from the COVID-19 virus, we are far from being out of the woods. Our lives will continue to be impacted by this virus pandemic for quite a while, even as we move into the yellow and green phases. With hearts that are heavy with concern and grief for those that have lost loved ones, we're grateful for the opportunity to come before the Lord in prayer. In the peace of the risen Christ, let us offer prayers to the Lord. Let us pray that our risen Savior may grant us victory over all our enemies, seen and unseen, that he may crush beneath our feet the prince of darkness and all evil powers, that he may raise us up and set us with him in heaven, that he may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection, that he may provide through us for those who lack food, work, and shelter, that by his love, wars and famine may cease through all the earth, that isolated and persecuted people and churches may find fresh strength in the gospel, that all those who have gone before us in the faith of Christ may find refreshment, light, and peace. We ask all these three things through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray when we are gathered together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, Collie, it looks like it's just the two of us for children's time again. We're here in the sanctuary, we're all by ourselves, but we decided to take a road trip. So we're actually over on the side, over by the piano, and we're about 4 feet up off the ground. So it's our insurance guy wouldn't want to see where we are right now. I want to show this window to you folks. It's a story of a portrayal of the story of the Good Samaritan. And as the story goes, a man was going from Jerusalem down the road towards Jericho, and some people came and jumped him, and they beat him up, and he was left on the side of the road. And who would come along but a priest, a guy from church? And instead of helping him, he crossed over the road and went on his business. And then another guy from church came by, and he did the same thing. He crossed over. But then a man from Samaria, he was one of their enemies, came, and he knelt down, and he cared for the guy, and he had compassion on him. Do you know what compassion means?
Yeah.
It means like he really cared for him. His heart was broken because the guy was hurting. And so he helped the guy onto his animal and took him down to an inn. And there he told the innkeeper to take care of him, and he would pay his bill whenever he returned. We really value people that care for others, people that have compassion, people like nurses. And we're celebrating nurses this week. So a couple questions for you. If you were playing on your skateboard or maybe riding your bike and you fell, would you want me to take you to a soccer player?
No.
How about a hockey player?
No.
How about a nurse?
Yes.
You'd go to a nurse. Okay. Let's say that you are in school and you got real, real sick. Would you want to go find the cafeteria lady?
No.
No, you love the cafeteria ladies, but that's not what they're for. And how about Mrs. Tyler? Mrs. Tyler is the best teacher in the world, isn't she?
Yeah.
But she's not really there.
I know, but it's mostly sometimes.
Sometimes. So it's whenever your stomach really hurts, where do you need to go?
The nurse.
You need to go to the nurse. So God gives us nurses to care for us. And this week we're celebrating them, and we're very happy and grateful for so many nurses. I know if I fell off of this thing, I'd hope that we would get Miss Wendy or Mr. Chad over here to take care of me, because that's what nurses do. They're always there to care for us. They're compassionate. So let's say thank you to our nurses. Thank you.
Thank you.
Last Sunday, we honored our mothers on Mother's Day. We also recognized the blessing of teachers. And last week I commented that there's likely not been a time in our history that we have appreciated teachers as much as we do during this pandemic season, when they've been forced to teach online without proper time for preparation and training. I also mentioned last week that there may not have been a time in our history when we have appreciated nurses as much as we do during this quarantine. Though we are not a large congregation, we have been blessed with a number of folks who have answered a call to the nursing profession. That shouldn't surprise anyone, as this is such a giving and serving congregation. To all those who have devoted their lives to being nurses, we say thank you. Thank you for your compassion, for your dedication, for using your gifts for the benefit of others. I've never viewed nursing as a job, but a calling. While the challenges facing nurses are increasingly more complex and difficult, you have the privilege and joy of being instruments of God's healing. Thank you for your willingness to work long hours, to be in harm's way, that we may be made well again. Thank you. A few of our nurses have offered to share what it has meant to be a nurse.
Hi, Unionville family. I miss everyone. And since Doug asked me to do a little talk on nursing, I decided I would tell you about my career in nursing. I was 40 years old when I went to college to become a nurse, and it was with God's help that I did this, and a lot of times it became a struggle, but I believed in the scripture of Romans 8:28, where we can do all things through Christ who gives us the strength, and everything works together for good to those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. So I graduated in 1983. I went to Passavant in January and had an interview because they had open house, and I was given a position that day if I wanted it. So I came home and discussed it with my husband, and he said, "It's up to you." So I took the job, and I started in May of 1983, and I worked. My first position was on 5 West, which was a med-surg pediatric floor. Sometimes we rocked babies at night in the croup tent. We took care of post-op patients, which was very challenging at times. And the children were quite an endeavor because a lot of them were really, really sick when they came in there. But then later on, they discontinued pediatrics at Passavant, and it was moved, of course, to Children's Hospital. I worked there for several years, and then I decided I wanted to learn more about cardiology. And I transferred to the telemetry unit and worked there for several years. One experience I had there as a nurse, I got a patient that was a young man one day, and he had been working outdoors and he passed out. And they brought him into Passavant, and he was admitted to the telemetry unit, and I was his nurse. He was only there a short while, and the monitor went into an alarm as he was having a fatal arrhythmia. And I walked in the room, and I ran, and I hit him in the chest, and I said, "You're not going to die on my shift." And he did survive, and we kind of laughed about it later, but it's what really saved his life at the time. After years of working there in the telemetry unit, I decided that I wanted to be closer home, and so I came to Cranberry to St. Francis Emergency Room. While there, we had lots of excitement. Many times we had just children with colds, adults with colds, flus. Sometimes alcoholism was a big problem. And we also had 4 babies born while I was born there, even though we were not a setup to deliver babies. We had a girl come in one time. Her mother ran in and said we had to help her daughter, and that she was having terrible stomach pains. And when my coworker and I went out to the car to get her, we put her on a gurney, and it's a good thing we did because her water broke. Well, her mother had no idea that she was even pregnant, but we delivered a 5-pound baby boy, and the West Penn neonatal unit came and assisted us. In all, it was a good experience, but as a nurse, I always kind of liked to know what my patients were, their diagnoses were, and had a plan before I entered the room. But in the ER nursing, you don't have a chance to do that. So I decided I wanted to go back to Passavant and work, and when I did, I worked in the ICU and CCU unit. That was quite an experience because it was a terrific learning experience in cardiology. We put Swan-Ganz catheters in. We did bronchoscopies and all different things in the unit. Taking care of the patients, sometimes they were repetitive patients because of breathing difficulties. We got post-ops from the OR and recovery. And it was always a joy to take care of a patient and see them get well and go into their homes. After a while of working this 7 to 7 days and nights, I got that I couldn't sleep, and it was causing me to have cardiac problems myself. So I decided that I would go and work for Tri-State Cardiology in Beaver. And I worked there for 13 years with the doctors, and it was rewarding, but looking back, it wasn't as rewarding as the hospital, because you actually saw people getting well in the hospital, and it was a satisfaction being a nurse to feel that maybe you had a part in that. So I really loved nursing. I missed it. To this day, I miss nursing. And I just know that God knew what he was doing when he left me become a nurse, because after retiring from nursing, I took care of my husband for 12 years, and because of his COPD. I have some scripture that I stand on as a learning tool. It's Proverbs 4:4-7. Then he taught me and said to me, "Let your heart hold fast to my words. Keep my commandments and love. Acquire wisdom, acquire understanding. Do not forget, nor turn away from the word of my mouth. Do not forsake me, and she will guard you. Love her, and she will watch over you. The beginning of wisdom is acquire wisdom, and with all your inquiring, get understanding." Nursing was a great career. Today, there's many avenues in nursing, and it's quite an adventure, but it's quite a career that gives you satisfaction. And I loved it, and I thank you for allowing me to give this little update on my career. Thank you for allowing me to be part of the service, and stay safe, and God bless.
Hi, Union Girl. It's Nurses Appreciation Week, and I've been asked to talk about what it was like to be a nurse. I guess I knew from like age 8 that I wanted to be a nurse. So I went on to nursing, graduated in 1967. At that time, I really enjoyed working in the nursery as a student nurse, and that's what I really wanted to do. But those positions were hard to come by, so I ended up going into medical surgical nursing. I worked at the Beaver Falls unit of the medical center until the new hospital was built in Brighton Township. And then I transferred to there and continued working at the new medical center. I worked there till about 1982 and decided I needed a change. So I applied at Passive and Retirement Center in Zoyanopol and got a position there. I have to say that was probably the most fulfilling years of my nursing career. I learned so much from the residents. I loved to listen to their stories of the Depression and World War II and all the experiences they had. I think the one thing that I learned at Passavant was how much the residents missed personal intervention and hugs. We ended up establishing a hug month every month, and everybody would be given stickers. And you would go around, if you got a hug, you got a sticker, or if you gave a hug, you gave a sticker. So the residents had a lot of fun seeing who could come up with the most stickers by the end of the day. And from that, somehow my office evolved as Hug Central. I always had my door open when I was at work. The residents could pop in anytime they wanted to. So lots of times they would just pop in and say, "Hey, I came for my hug today." So, or they'd pop in and plop down in my easy chair and tell me a story that I'd probably heard 10 times before. Could probably repeat it verbatim. But I would sit and listen to them all the time, thinking, "Oh my gosh, I've got so much to do today. How am I going to get it all done?" But it was important to them, so therefore it was important to me. When I was around 60, I was offered an administrator's position at Passavant, which meant I had to go back to school to get my administrator's license. So off to Penn State Beaver I went. Boy, talk about feeling like a duck out of water. Those kids looked so young. But I enjoyed it. I enjoyed that time there and got my license and spent the rest of my time at Passavant as an administrator until I retired. My car was always kind of prayer central. I would always pray on my way to work that I would do the best I could for my patients and that I would always treat them the way that I would want my parents to be treated. I pray every day for our healthcare workers and I would like to leave them with these words from Philippians 4:13, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Remember, nurses, you are not perfect. You can only do the best you can. But we have a God that is perfect. And if you ask Him, He will be with you every day. As you go through your daily routine, you'll feel His presence. And He'll help you to resolve those situations that you think that you cannot do, and go back the next day and do again. So to all you nurses out there, I want to say, God bless you. Have a happy Nurses Week. And I have to tell you, you're my heroes.
Hi, Unionville family. This is Kelly Harris. I hope this finds you well. I am coming to you this evening to share some thoughts on nursing and the profession of nursing and what that means to me, and what it's meant to me to be a part of that profession. Being a nurse has brought me immense pride and joy, and it has afforded me the opportunity to work alongside some really amazing individuals who just provide extraordinary care with such compassion every day and do that selflessly. And they are amazing folks, and not just nurses, many other clinicians as well. And we appreciate them for all their effort and their work as well. Being a nurse has meant so much to me. We're taught in nursing school that nursing is not only a science, but it's also an art. And we get the opportunity to not only study the human body and how it all works together and the mechanics of it, but you also get to study the human condition and the spirit of the human being and their emotional health. And you get to take pride and special care in how you deliver the science of it. And that's what's always been unique to me. You know, it's been a combination of medicine and miracles. And I've been blessed to be able to see both and in this field. And I'm forever grateful for that. I thank all fellow nurses out there for their continued efforts and their compassionate care and their wisdom and their leadership. And I say thank you to them today, along with each of you. And I thank you for thinking of me when thinking of nurses. I hope this finds you well and you stay blessed.
I'm proud of our mom and dad because our mom trains other nurses to become better nurses to take care of people.
And I'm proud of my mom and dad because my dad, he works in the emergency room, and every day he goes, he sees different things happening, and once he's ready to go home, he's excited, like all nurses probably. So, we're proud of our parents!
Yeah! Hi, I'm Mary Kuhn. And this is my granddaughter, Tara Gardner. We're both nurses. I haven't been working the past 2 months due to COVID-19. I've been a nurse for 29 years. 25 of those years, I've worked as an ophthalmic nurse. And the last 15, I've worked as an ophthalmic nurse for Dr. Nadler and Dr. Cook. I do all the cataract surgery measurements, and I also assist with office surgeries. There's nothing more exciting than having a patient come in that has a vision of 2400, which is the big E, and having cataract surgery done and being able to read the 2020 or the 2025 line. They are so grateful, and I'm so excited to think that they would get such good results. I worked at the geriatric center several years with Nancy Liston and Charlotte Plouffe. And Nancy and I used to do drive-through injections long before these injections, drive-through injections, and the drive-through testing was done. Nancy would take B12 injections. She'd give me a call, tell me she was coming over. Nancy would come over. She couldn't get up our steps out front at the house, so I would go out with my alcohol swab, get the syringe. Nancy rolls down the window. I give her injection, and she's on her way. So we were doing drive-through injections long before they were ever doing them now. Tara has some things to talk to you about.
Hi, everyone. I am Mary Kuhn's granddaughter, and I have been a nurse now for just about a year. So my grandma has a little bit more knowledge than I do when it comes to nursing. But for the past few years, since 2017, I've worked at Pasevant Hospital. And right now I'm on the cardiac step-down unit. So that means my main population of patients is patients that come in with active heart attacks. So nothing is more satisfying and rewarding than taking care of a patient on day one with an active heart attack, 10 out of 10 chest pain, and being able to safely discharge that same patient maybe a day or two later back home with stent placement or whatever it may be. It's been a little bit different working during the COVID-19 pandemic. I have still been working through this, taking all the proper precautions and wearing our personal protective equipment. But I can tell you that we will get through this together. We're a strong community and have a strong faith. And my grandma has picked out a couple readings that we want to share with you. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. So the first one is from the 2 Thessalonians 2:16-17. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word.
Mine's from Psalms 56, 3 and 4. When I am afraid, I will trust in you, in God whose word I praise. In God I trust, I will not be afraid. We hope everybody is well. Stay at home. Do what the governor is telling us to do. And we will get through this. There are better days ahead.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
I look forward to our time together each and every week. Friends, as I've continued to say, we're still learning how to do this distance thing, and I'm so pleased that you are here for this time of praise and worship. I invite you to continue checking in with our Facebook page and our website, and we'd love to have you on our email distribution as well. If you're not there already, please drop an email to our office and we'll remedy that. We all look forward to the day when we come back to the sanctuary. But know that that day is not very near. Our administrative board and board of trustees have been meeting via Zoom to begin making preparations for us gathering once again. But I can't imagine that we'll be coming together prior to moving into the green phase. So I'm grateful for our ability to have this time together online. I'd also like to share a couple of other quick items. For those who like to know the flow of our worship time each week, we do post a bulletin on our website. You may go there and follow along if you prefer. And if you lack internet access at home, feel free to come down to the church. And if you park outside the office or sanctuary entrance, you can pick up the signal as Unionville guest. Or if you have a loved one or a neighbor who lacks internet access at all, we have the service available on an iPad, which can be picked up at the church office. It's a one-button operation, as simple as it could be. So thank you for spending time with us. I hope you find this time uplifting and meaningful. May you have a blessed week. Allow me to offer today's benediction. May the Spirit of God be in you. May the Spirit of God go ahead of you and come behind you. May God's Spirit stand beside you, guard over you from above, and support you from below. May the Spirit comfort you, tell you all you need to know, and give you power to serve. May the Spirit unite you with God and with the children of God to live a holy and fruitful life. May it be so. Amen. Friends, go in peace.